you know, thanking everyone for being here and welcoming everyone on behalf of the local organizing committee. Just to give you a general idea of the of this meeting, when it was, I think, initially conceived, the general idea was to stimulate collaborations between mathematicians in Brazil and Australia with common interests in, I think, well, topology, geometry, and algebra related to mathematical physics. And but obviously, you know, we thought it would be much more fun to invite people from all over the place, you know, Canada, US, Europe. So what else? I'll give you, you know, later in the day, more information about the social events. Later today, there will be a reception after the very last talk at 6 p.m. here, just outside. On Wednesday, we'll have a free afternoon and we'll organize, you know, an excursion somewhere, most likely the Sugarloaf, but possibly with other options too, for those who have been there. And on Wednesday evening, we'll have the conference dinner at a barbecue place. More information to come. So I think that we'll have a very interesting and exciting week ahead of us. So the first talk, it is my great pleasure to have Eckhard Myrinken from Toronto, who will talk about spinor bundles for Hamiltonian loop group spaces.
Well, thanks a lot. Thanks so much for the invitation. It's a great pleasure to be here. So coming from Toronto, I suppose, well, Canada is part of the Commonwealth, so this might count as part of the Australian contingent. So Hamiltonian loop group spaces is a subject that I actually started working on together with Chris Woodward in 1996. So it's kind of shocking that this is like 20 years ago. But I just keep coming back to the subject because even though we figure out lots of things, there's still some aspects that we're not completely happy with. In particular, regarding the quantization of Hamiltonian loop group spaces, we have some approach that works somewhat abstractly as some push forward and twisted K-theory, but it's not very concrete. It's a little bit abstract, and we want to make it more concrete, more explicit, so to actually involve some Dirac operators, spin C structures, and all that. And so this is part of what this project is about. So this is an excerpt of a joint project with my student Yannis Loizides and my former postdoc Yan-Li Song. So let's set the stage. So the setting I want to consider here today is that we have a compact Lie group G, Lie algebra script G. I denote by LG the loop group, which I will take to be loops of some Sobolev class S greater than 1/2. So one shouldn't worry too much about Sobolev classes if one doesn't know the subject too much. It's just to make it into a Banach-Lie group. So we don't just allow smooth loops, we allow something a bit more general. But one has to take a class greater than 1/2 because that's the range where the loops are continuous and so multiplication actually makes sense. And then one knows that this is actually Banach-Lie group. The product is, again, of Sobolev class S and so on. Okay, I denote by A the space of connections, so Lie algebra valued one forms on the circle, which I have to take of Sobolev class S minus 1 with the same S as before. Equipped with the gauge action. So it's the action by gauge transformations, the adjoint action minus DGG inverse. So you see, because it involves a derivative of G, that's why we have to take Sobolev class S minus 1. Derivative lowers this Sobolev class by 1. And this then, a smooth action of this Banach-Lie group on a Banach manifold. And so it's kind of nice. And I've also picked some invariant metric on G. So if G is semi-simple, I might take the Killing form, for instance, in order to identify the Lie algebra and its dual. And then I will use it also to identify the space of connections as some sort of dual of the Lie algebra of the loop group, which one shouldn't take too literally. So the duality pairing, of course, between connections on the circle and Lie algebra valued functions on the circle is given by taking the pointwise inner product and then integrating over the circle. But there's two small problems here. For one thing, it's not the actual dual space. It's like more like a smooth dual. And secondly, we're using this gauge action. We're not using the pointwise cotron action. But for the purpose of Hamiltonian loop group spaces, it takes the role of dual of the Lie algebra. So the definition of Hamiltonian loop group space is it is itself a Banach manifold with a loop group action, smooth loop group action, and with a weak symplectic form. Weak symplectic means that the map from the tangent bundle to the cotangent bundle that it defines is only injective, not necessarily surjective. It's not necessarily an isomorphism. So one has to allow a weakly symplectic because otherwise there are no examples. And then there should be some equivariant moment map, so loop group equivariant moment map for this equivalent relative to the gauge action, satisfying the usual moment map condition. The main examples of such Hamiltonian loop group spaces are cotangent orbits of the loop group, so just the orbits of the LG action on the space of connections, and moduli spaces of flat connections on surfaces with boundary. So surface with boundary, compact oriented surfaces with boundary like this. Then the moduli space of flat connections would be the flat connections on that surface, up to gauge transformations, which are trivial along the boundary. And this space then still has an action of all the gauge transformations, mod those which are trivial along the boundary. And just that just is the gauge group of the boundary, so it's the loop group. So that's another important example for Hamiltonian loop group space. And one can view this quotient as a symplectic reduction. So in this way, one obtains a symplectic two-form. So that's very well known. But there are other examples which are not as easy to describe, so I'm not going to describe them at this point. Any questions? So that's a Hamiltonian loop group space. Of course, infinite dimensional, but the nice thing about Hamiltonian loop group spaces is if they're what we call proper Hamiltonian loop group spaces, meaning that the moment map is proper, you can translate everything into finite dimensional terms. So that's what we call a quasi-Hamiltonian G-space, something finite dimensional. So every proper Hamiltonian loop group space determines a finite dimensional quasi-Hamiltonian G-space, which has an invariant two-form. It has an equivariant moment map taking values in the group G, so equivariant relative to the conjugation action. And it satisfies certain axioms that actually don't really matter for my talk, so I'm not going to state them here. I'm going to say on the next slide how this correspondence goes, but let me first give the examples. So if our Hamiltonian loop group space is a cotangent orbit, then this finite dimensional space would be a conjugacy class of the group. It's basically the possible holonomies of a connection. And if my loop group space is the moduli space of flat connections on the surface with one boundary component, then this finite dimensional space, again, is a space of holonomies. It's the representation manifold homomorphism from the fundamental group into G. So it's just a product of some copies of G. The moment map in this case is the product of the Lie group commutators. Yeah, yeah, it's in both directions. So it's a one-to-one correspondence. I haven't written down what the axioms are for a quasi-Hamiltonian G-space, which I can if we have time. But it goes both ways. So it's actually a useful way of constructing new Hamiltonian loop group spaces because we can construct these finite dimensional spaces. We know that how that goes. So here's how this correspondence goes. That's my new favorite way of looking at it. So we're looking at the space of quasi-periodic paths in the group G. So meaning that gamma of t plus 1 is not exactly gamma of t, but only gamma of t up to a constant. So you might think of this as all the possible holonomy functions for a connection on the circle. But we don't necessarily start with an initial condition gamma of zero is equal to identity. Gamma of zero could be anything. And there are two maps from this space of quasi-periodic paths. One is to the space of connections. So taking a quasi-periodic path gamma to the connection gamma inverse d gamma. So that's the connection which has this path as a holonomy. And then there's another map to the group G, which is the holonomy. So gamma of 1, gamma of 0 inverse. And both of these maps are principal bundles. So the map P is a principal G bundle. And the map Q is a principal LG bundle. So this is a very well-known principal loop group bundle over the group G. And so this is what we're using. The key fact here is that on this space PG, there's a certain completely explicit, but I'm not going to write it down, two form, which is invariant under the LG times G action. By the way, the loop group action on such space, on such a path is multiplication from the right by a loop. The G action is multiplication from the left by a group element. And so these two actions commute. And on this space PG, one has this two form, which is invariant under the LG times G action, and is such that the contractions with generating vector fields for the loop group action produce this term, which is just like the term which one has on the right-hand side of the moment map condition. And actually, these two properties alone already imply that the differential of this form var pi and contractions with the generating vectors for the G action are basic. So they descend to the group G. So maybe I should actually write this down in full detail. So we have this condition, the contraction with the generating vector fields for the loop group action of var pi is this d mu xi. So I'm saying that if I take contractions with the generating vector fields for the G action, that's basic for the other direction. So it's a pullback under Q of something. This something one can figure out is theta L plus theta R over 2 dot x, where these are the Mauer-Cartan forms, G inverse dG and dGG inverse. And d of var pi is the pullback, actually this was a minus sign, a pullback of a 3 form on the group. Well, this is the Cartan 3 form, theta L, theta L, theta L. So it has these nice properties. There's no, so this var pi is degenerate, but one property it has is that kernel of var pi intersect kernel of tp intersect kernel of tq is zero. So this property is somehow important in language of Dirac geometry, but again, I don't want to get into that. So this two form one can use to make a Hamiltonian loop group space into a quasi-Hamiltonian G space. So we basically take the diagram which we had before. So we have this loop group space with the map into A. We have a principal G bundle, and we just pull it back and get a space N. And so we get a similar diagram with involving our Hamiltonian loop group space. Over it, a principal G bundle, which also has a loop group action, and we can descend to a finite dimensional space M. And the two forms are related, like I wrote in the formula. So we basically add to the two form which we have on the loop group space, this form var pi, then it becomes basic for the loop group direction, and then it descends. And this goes both ways. So on as an example for conjugacy classes, we have this two form sigma, which we can then write down. So this we use a lot. So the correspondence for cogent orbits and conjugacy looks like this. So they're all orbits. in one case, one has the orbit through a connection. In one case, one has the orbit of one of these quasi-periodic paths. And then you have the conjugacy class, which is the orbit under conjugation action. All right, so that's the setup. Now let's make some claims. So the first claim that I want to explain is that every proper Hamiltonian loop group space has a canonical LG equivariant spin C structure. Of course, I have to explain this quite a bit. What do I mean by spin C structure in infinite dimensions? So let me make this claim a bit more explicit and more detailed. So what I really mean is the following. So first of all, the tangent bundle of my loop group space, it has a canonical completion on which the two form actually becomes strongly symplectic. And on, so it becomes an actual symplectic vector bundle, but in a strong sense. Furthermore, this symplectic vector bundle has a compatible complex structure, compatible in the sense of symplectic geometry. I'll get back to this in a moment. But it's in a certain equivalence class. So this compatibility alone is not quite enough to pin things down. So it has to lie in a certain polarization class. Again, I will explain this a bit more later on. And so using the complex structure and the symplectic form, you get a metric, and you get a spinor module. So you take the 0-1 part of, it's just the usual construction which one has in finite dimensions. You take the 0-1 part of the tangent bundle, you take the exterior algebra over that. Here one has to take a completion to make it into a Hilbert space. Right, and the Clifford algebra acts on that. No, but one doesn't need Kähler. I mean, one just needs an almost complex structure. That's all. Yeah, so when I say complex structure here, I mean complex structure on a vector bundle. There's no assumption of integrability. All right, and furthermore about these, so we can sort of rephrase this in this finite dimensional picture. So to every Hamiltonian loop group space, we have the corresponding finite dimensional quasi-Hamiltonian G space, described by this diagram. And the next claim is that for this finite dimensional space, I have what I call a twisted spin C structure. So it's not actually a spin C structure on M itself. What I do is I take the tangent bundle of M and pull it back to this bigger space N, so to this principal LG bundle over M. And on that pullback bundle, we have a spin C structure, but it's only equivariant under some central extension of the loop group. So if it were invariant under the loop group itself, then it would descend to TM. So that's not quite true, but it's equivariant for a central extension. Yeah, and so that's what we have. So this central extension is not the basic central extension of the loop group, it's what we call a spin central extension. And yeah, as I said, we think of this as a twisted spin C structure on M. So one can consider a situation like this in other contexts, as for example, this work of Mattia Meros on a fractional index, and they basically consider twisted spin C structures, but on a finite dimensional principal bundle. So here we have an infinite dimensional principal bundle. All right, so these are two claims, and there are going to be more claims, and I'm going to explain why these things are true. Yeah? Let's see. Okay. No? Yeah? Oh, the top wedge power. Oh, but there's no notion of top wedge power. It goes. No, it's not the top exterior power. No, it's simply the exterior algebra. It's the exterior Yeah. And so the exterior algebra and Clifford algebra you define just like in finite dimensions. Clifford algebra is generated by the elements of the tangent bundle up to some equivalence relation. Exterior algebra, same thing. It's just if I do this, then the exterior algebra is not going to be a Hilbert space bundle, but it has a pre-Hilbert structure, and so one can just take the completion. The Clifford algebra, I don't do anything, so I don't bother completing this in any way. Any other questions? Right, so I want to explain things a little bit, and so let me recall some background about spinor bundles. First, in the finite dimensional case. So we suppose we have a finite dimensional Riemannian manifold. For simplicity, I'm just going to consider the case that the dimension is even. And we consider its Clifford bundle as a Z2 graded algebra bundle. Then a spin C structure on such a Riemannian manifold is just the same thing as a Z2 graded spinor bundle. So it's a module for the Clifford algebra with a property that the module action identifies the Clifford bundle itself with endomorphisms. So it's a reasonably well-known fact that this is really equivalent to the other notion of spin C structure that you may know as lift of the structure group from SON to spin CN. So if one has this lift of the structure group, then one can construct the spinor bundle, but it's an observation that one can actually also go back. So the spinor bundle determines the lift of the structure group, and so you can take this as a definition. Right, and so what does one know about spin C structures? So if a spin C structure exists, of course there's a condition. If it exists, then any two spin C structures differ by a Lyman bundle. So you look at the Lyman bundle of intertwining operators between the two spinor bundles. And so the space of intertwining operators is a Lyman bundle, that's one claim. And well, if you know that, then it's clear that S prime is just S tensor L. So any two spin C structures are obtained by twisting by a Lyman bundle. It's a Lyman bundle with a Z2 grading, strictly speaking. So it's either even or odd. So you might reverse the parity. So that's one important fact. Second fact, also very well known, is that if you have an orthogonal complex structure on the tangent bundle, that determines a spinor bundle. Like what I had on the previous slide, so you take the exterior power of the 0,1 part of the tangent bundle, and on that one has an action of the Clifford algebra in the usual way. I'm sure you've seen this. So you take elements of the tangent bundle, you decompose them into the 0,1 part and 1,0 part. The 0,1 part acts by exterior multiplication, the 1,0 part acts by contraction. That's how it goes, and that's how it goes in finite dimensions. But in infinite dimensions, it's a bit more complicated. There's some twisted, and so let's see how this goes in infinite dimensions. So now I'm going to assume I have a real Hilbert space. So I have in mind a real Hilbert manifold, but I'm just going to do it pointwise. And yeah, so I assume that we have an orthogonal complex structure. So as before, this defines a spinor module. I mean, I'm just defining this to be a spinor module. I'm not saying anything about endomorphisms being all the Clifford algebra. This is my definition of spinor module. So this definition I can make. But then the question arises, are any two of these isomorphic? And so unlike finite dimensions, this is no longer true in infinite dimensions. But this story was all figured out in the 1960s already, particularly in work of Araki and Shale Steinspring and some other papers. And this is very precise condition, that the two spinor modules corresponding to two complex structures are isomorphic, if and only if these orthogonal complex structures differ by a Hilbert-Schmidt operator. Very precise. And if that's the case, then again, the space of intertwining operators is one-dimensional. Right, so that's why in infinite dimensions we have to be more careful about the choice of complex structure. We can just take anything. And so it has to lie in some, what we call polarization class, which means equivalence up to Hilbert Schmidt. Yeah, and so another aspect of the story, essentially a consequence of this last part is that the so-called restricted orthogonal group gets a central extension. So the restricted orthogonal group for a given complex structure are all the transformations which preserve the complex structure up to Hilbert-Schmidt. And so the spinor modules corresponding to J and G pullback J, they're going to be isomorphic. And this means that such a group element can be, as I say, implemented in the spinor module. But the implementation is only unique up to a scalar, and that gives rise to a central extension. So there's the central extension of this restricted orthogonal group. Okay, so that's in very brief terms the story for the infinite dimensional case. So there's this beautiful book by Plyman and Robinson where one can read about the history and all the details about this story. Okay, so for our context, the way we apply this is let's look at the Lie algebra of the loop group. But this time, I'm not going to take Sobolev class. I have to complete it with respect to L2 norms. So we really look at L2 loops. And we look at the corresponding Fourier decomposition. So positive Fourier modes, negative Fourier modes, and zero Fourier modes. So this almost gives a complex structure on LG. By saying that the 1-0 space would be LG plus. But it's just this zero Fourier modes that we have to take care of. But we can take care of that quite easily by just adding on an extra copy of G. Right? So if we make an extra copy of G, then that has an orthogonal complex structure. But again, the 1-0 space, let's put it this way. The way to look at it is LG plus G contains G plus G. That has a natural complex structure. So the first G being the zero Fourier modes. And then we have LG minus plus LG plus. So there's also complex structure. So this has an orthogonal complex structure. That's good. And so we get a spinor module for the general story. And now the next nice thing that one can prove is that, on this space, we have LG times G acting by the adjoint action, pointwise adjoint action. And one proves that this actually, preserves the metric. And this lies in the restricted orthogonal group. And so it gets a central extension. And so that's what I meant by this spin central extension of the loop group. So this is my LG hat. And by construction, it acts on the spinor module. So the loop group itself does not, but this LG hat does. All right, so that's one bit that I need. I also need something about compatible complex structures because my setting is actually a little bit different. In my setting, I don't really have a Riemannian metric to begin with. I really have the symplectic structure to begin with. So let's look at that setting. So I don't really have a Hilbert space in the sense that I have a metric. I just have a Hilbert tuple space, meaning that there exists some metric that defines the topology. And on that, I have a strong symplectic form. So I'm looking at the setting where I've done my completion with a bar. Okay, in this context, just like one does in finite dimensions, one can look at compatible complex structures. So a complex structure on such a space is compatible with the two form if this formula defines a Riemannian metric. So that's the standard setting which one does in finite dimensions. But in infinite dimensions, there's now the question, are any two of these homotopic? So in finite dimensions, one knows the space of compatible complex structures is contractible. So it doesn't really matter which one you take. In infinite dimensions, that's not true. Well, what we can prove is the following. If you have two compatible complex structures that differ by a Hilbert-Schmidt operator, then indeed they're homotopic. Through compatible complex structures that all differ by Hilbert-Schmidt operators. So within a given polarization class, you're good. So the proof is basically the standard proof which one does in finite dimensions. One, if one looks at the proof very carefully, one needs some technical assumptions to make it work in infinite dimensions, and Hilbert Schmidt is good enough. All right, and secondly, we have this fact that you can find you can define the square root of minus j1 j0, and that's some isometry between these two metrics. So in a way, it doesn't really matter which metric you work with to define the Clifford algebra, because there's a canonical way of going between the two. So that's another fact we need. So let me now explain how our construction goes. But first, just in the case of cogent orbits, because that kind of explains lots of things. So we look at some cogent orbit of the loop group, and this is the formula for this symplectic form, it's a weak symplectic form. So covariant derivative of some xi. So it's a symplectic form on two generating vector fields. Xi and zeta are in the Lie algebra of the loop group, and xi sub O and zeta sub O are the corresponding vector fields. And the formula is an integral over S1 of the covariant derivative of xi dot zeta, pointwise inner product. So it's the analog of the Kirilov, Kostza, and Suriot symplectic form on finite dimensional cogent orbits. But you can see it's only a weak symplectic form. And I mean, even if you don't know much about Sobolev classes, it's kind of clear, because one fact that's very standard about Sobolev spaces is that the dual of Sobolev space HS is H minus S, if you use the metric to make the duality. But this d mu xi has Sobolev class, not minus S, has Sobolev class 1 minus S. Right? And in general, 1 minus S is not equal to minus S. So you would have 1 minus S is equal to minus S exactly if S is equal to 1/2. Which unfortunately is exactly the borderline case where our loop group is no longer a group. I get it. this is an S minus one, yes. Otherwise, the calculation is not right. S minus one, yeah. Which is exactly the borderline case where the loop group is no longer a group. But that's okay. So now we take this completion of the tangent bundle. We simply replace LG with loops of Sobolev class 1/2. That's the completion that's basically dictated to us by the formula for the symplectic form. And then by construction, it becomes strongly symplectic on that. So we take the same underlying manifold, but we just thicken the tangent bundle a little bit to make it strongly symplectic there. Okay, and there's in this case an explicit compatible complex structure given by this formula, and a corresponding Riemannian metric. So for cogent orbits, one can make everything very explicit. Now the thing is, this trick that we did for cogent orbits actually works in general. So in general, if we have a proper Hamiltonian loop group space, we can always thicken the tangent bundle in basically the same way. So in a way, the direction, the idea is, if you have a Hamiltonian loop group space, then up to finitely many co-dimensions, everything is taken care of by loop group directions. So the LG orbits in M, they have finite co-dimension. And so again, what we're doing is basically just replace these LG directions with this Sobolev 1/2 completion. But the formula is quite simple. It's just that. And then one can check that on this completion, the two form becomes strongly symplectic, and we can find compatible complex structure. This time, of course, we have to be careful of which one we choose. But again, this is sort of dictated by the orbit directions, because LG has away from the zero Fourier modes, it has a complex structure. And so we take it Hilbert-Schmidt close to that. So that determines our equivalence class. So this can also be done. And so once we've nailed down the equivalence class, the polarization, then we get our spinner module. And it's essentially unique because in the constructions, everything is unique up to some deformation. So that explains the first claim that I had made. So now about the second claim. So now we're going back to this diagram that we used to get to the finite dimensional space. So what we have to do here to make things work is that we have to choose splittings of the two maps. So it's essentially choosing connections, but they have to be chosen in a slightly careful way so that they actually extend to the completions. So as a matter of fact, if you think about it, this bundle PG over A is actually a trivial principal G bundle. The trivialization is given by the based paths as a section. But if you would take just the corresponding trivial connection, that wouldn't work. It wouldn't extend to the completions. So we actually have to work a little bit harder. But it's not difficult, and so we get these splittings for the completed tension bundle. So it's completed in exactly the same way like we did before. Always replace the LG directions with this Sobolev 1/2 completion. Okay. And so if we just pull back everything under the Mohn maps, then we get completions for these spaces, the loop group space M and the finite dimensional one is in the picture. And well, the splittings allow us then to define an orthogonal complex structure on Tn plus G, so N being the space upstairs, right? Because on Tm, we already had an orthogonal complex structure, and G plus G has a canonical one, so we just put the two together. And so that's then the way we sort of lift the complex structure on M to a complex structure on N, but we have to add on these extra G, just like we did actually for the LG just a few slides back. And so we get the corresponding spinner module. So the idea of what we were trying to do is we have this spinner module over M. We sort of want to pull it back to N and then descend it. So this is the first step of pulling it back to N. But we have to add on this extra G direction. Okay, so that's what we have done so far. So we've pulled it back to N, and everything is equivalent for the LG times G action. And now we want to descend. All right. So to descend, we use this splitting for the other direction. So then Tn becomes LG bar plus Tm, and so we get this. And now we think we're already kind of done, because LG plus G, we had the CVC structure just a few slides back. So we think we're kind of done, and we use this spinner module that we had a few slides back, and then we define the spinner module as the space of homomorphisms. Well, that's the idea, but of course we've gone a little bit too fast here. And it's not quite right yet. Because the problem is that we had these various completions here in the picture, right? So we have this LG bar, which was Sobolev class 1/2. But in the construction of the spinner module for LG, we used L2 loops. So that doesn't quite fit together yet. And besides, the metrics are not quite compatible. So there's some work that we actually have to do. So first of all, we have to identify the two as vector spaces. And so that's where we have to actually work a little bit. So actually, to make sense of this formula, we have to choose some identification between this fattened LG, which is L2 loops, and the bar LG, which is Sobolev class 1/2 loops. So S bundles over N, and the whole thing has to be made G times LG equivalent. okay, well, the isomorphism is actually kind of dictated to us because we have this covariant derivative operator. We take this square root of that, and that is a map from LG bar to LG because it loses one half a derivative. The only problem is it's not an isomorphism because there's zero modes and it has a kernel. But this we can easily fix by choosing some cutoff function which kind of gets rid of the kernel. So we choose this cutoff function chi of t, which is positive in a neighborhood of zero, and just for large t, it's the identity. So it just changes this operator del mu square root on some finite dimensional subspace, right? It's just near the kernel. It's an elliptic operator, so it's only near the zero eigenspace. It gets modified a little bit. It's not a very big deal. But in any case, so this is the identification as vector bundles. And the mu that appears here, of course, is the image under the moment map. Right? So we have our loop group space, M, it maps into A, and this mu is then the image of some point in M. It's connection. Right. So once this is done, this definition, well, almost makes sense. The only little problem is that the metrics are not quite the same, but by this trick that I had before, we can make some automorphisms to actually match up the metrics as well. And then, voila, we have this twisted spin C structure. So that's that construction. Any questions here? Yes, so in the end, the idea is constructing a quantization of this Hamiltonian loop group space as, roughly speaking, index of a Dirac operator. But in infinite dimensions, that's kind of tricky to do because analysis in infinite dimensions we don't like so much. But we're using this finite dimensional G space and want to quantize that. So by this construction, we get this twisted spin C structure on a finite dimensional space, and then one has to go on. Of course, that I can... Not in this talk, but but we basically know how to do this by now. So that's what I was saying earlier. So as a push forward and twisted K homology, we kind of know already how to do it. And here I'm basically trying to make it a bit more explicit with spin C structures and so on. Yeah, so this approach that we already have, it's done directly. We don't go to the loop group space at all, but it's done directly, but very abstractly, right? So there's some, as I said, there's this push forward and twisted K homology, which somehow works, but then the question is, what does it mean? So I'm trying to understand, what does it mean? I mean, hopefully, at some point, we also understand some Dirac operators in infinite dimensions, but so we're certainly not there yet. Any other questions? Yeah. So some remarks. So as I just said, so this twisted spin structure is one of the ingredients in our quantization of quasi-Hamiltonian spaces or Hamiltonian loop group spaces, which are equivalent. And by construction, this twisted spin T structure that we get is independent of all the choices because everything is unique up to deformation. So it's basically canonical. And in the case of Korjian orbits, or equivalently conjugacy classes, we can actually make everything completely canonical. So there were some choices involved, like this choice of a splitting and this choice of a we had this cutoff function to change the operator a little bit. So for Korjian orbits, one can make everything completely explicit. And so one gets a completely canonical spinner module. So bottom line is, conjugacy classes of a compact Lie group have a completely canonical twisted spin C structure. Which should be compared to cogent orbits of a compact group. Hmm? So cogent orbits of a compact group, of course, have a canonical complex structure, and hence they have a canonical spin C structure. For conjugacy class one, it only has a twisted spin C structure. But still good. So I want to explain another viewpoint of basically the same thing in terms of Morita morphisms, which is closer to what we initially had with our quasi-Hamiltonian spaces. So again, let's look at this diagram with the principal G bundle over our loop group space and the principal LG bundle over the finite dimensional space. And so what we've done is we have constructed the spinner module for Tn plus G. And in order to descend, we use the splitting that Tn plus G is the pullback of the tangent bundle of M plus LG plus G. So now we fixed it also with the matrix and everything. Right, and so because of that, in particular the Clifford bundle of the pullback of Tm acts on the spinner bundle. And on the other hand, I have the action of the Clifford bundle of LG plus G, but I also have the action of just compact operators of the spinner module of LG plus G. So I prefer to have this act from the right, so I get opposite. So this algebra of compact operators is what's called a Dixmier Duardy algebra. So it's basically like an algebra of matrices, but in infinite dimensions. Because compact operators are the norm closure of the finite rank operators. Right, so if this picture, and what's nice about this diagram now is that the loop group acts on everything without having to go to any central extension, right? On this LG plus G, we only had the action of the central extension of the loop group. But if I look at compact operators, the loop group itself acts. Because the central circle, how it acts on the space of operators is just trivial. So the action descends to an action of the loop group itself. So I have these two actions in the spinner module, and the loop group acts on everything, so I can just take the quotient by LG. Right, so to just take these two actions and the module in the middle and take the quotient by LG. And then what we get is this picture. So I get some bundle E. The bundle E is, again, the quotient of the spinner module by the loop group. Then quotient of cliff of Q star Tm by the loop group is just cliff of Tm. And the thing that acts on the right with this compact operators is the pullback of the bundle over the group. So it's this Dixmier Duardy bundle over the group. And that's an important bundle over the group because it sort of corresponds to the central extension of the spin central extension of the loop group again, but it's a different viewpoint. So DD bundles over a manifold, they're classified by integral H3, and this is the same integral H3 that corresponds to the central extension of the loop group. Right, so you get this bimodule structure. Right. So we think of this bimodule structure as defining a Morita morphism from the Clifford bundle to this DD bundle over the group. So let's look again. So having this bimodule structure, that's what we think of as a Morita morphism. So maybe I should explain this in a bit more. So if you have two Hilbert space bundles, and you have a bimodule. Like this, then this is called a Morita equivalence. If the local picture for this is compact operates on one Hilbert space, acting on compact operators from one Hilbert space to the other Hilbert space. So if fiber-wise, it's like that. And this is exactly the situation we have here. And so it's a Morita equivalence in that sense. And so we get this Morita morphism, and that's the kind of thing which one needs in twisted K-theory to push things forward. So in this earlier work, as I mentioned, this more abstract approach, we had very different methods of obtaining this Morita morphism, but now it's obtained quite explicitly with spin C structures and so on. Okay, so I'm wondering if maybe I should just stop here. We have some more applications of our approach. For example, to abelianization of Hamiltonian loop group spaces. But I think it's probably better to just stop here and just take some questions.